quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana. Radio. Radio. Show.
The Medical Marijuana for you and me. Ah, yeah, the Medical Marijuana. Whoa, 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 yeah, the Medical. It's the Medical Marijuana Show. And you will know.
Barry, you there? Okay, sir, we'll do it. Bye. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Medical Marijuana Radio for Saturday, the 23rd of March, 2013. Tonight, we're going to talk about hemp and using hemp as nutrition and cooking with hemp and get a little history of hemp. We know a lot about the marijuana and the medical side of things, but there's other benefits. And we're going to talk to Derek Cross, who will call in at about 20 minutes after the hour. And, of course, I'm your host, Larry Love. And we'll start off right now with the strain report for New Mexico. Cannaceutics will have this coming week their favorite strain called Shit. And then Ghost Train Haze, OG18, G13 Diesel, and Kosher Kush. Now, the Kosher Kush I love, and you guys should try that out. And that was Cannaceutics. High Desert Relief. We'll have Blue Dream, Bubba Double Snowman, New York City Diesel, and that's from High Desert Relief. Coming up this week at Minerva, they will have Agent Orange, Blackwater, Dark Star, Harvest Blend, Lemon Sour Diesel, Purple Mr. Nice, Satori, and Zozobra. That's from Minerva. New Mexican will have Blue Dream. They will have Shiva Skunk, CBD AK-47, and Mazar. And they also have Pressed Keef Hash, which is Trainwreck, 2-gram puck, $70. Loose Keef Hash, Topper from LA Confidential Strain, it's 1-gram for $35. Black Temple Hash, made from Blue Dream, $35 a gram. Popcorn Buds, made from AK-47, eighth for $32 plus tax. Also, Blue Dream and Critical Plus Wax, that's BHO Wax, a half a gram for $35, and 1 gram for $70. That's New Mexican. Next will be New Mexico Top Organics. Jack Star, RX, and X's Gum are available from New Mexico Top Organics. Our Greenleaf will have Super Lemon Haze, one of my favorite strains. Check it out. Shishka Berry, Cataract Kush, limited availability, MK Ultra Limited, and Lemon Sour Diesel. That's Our Greenleaf in Albuquerque. Now, here's an announcement. The New Mexico Medical Cannabis Patients Alliance, new meeting location. Do not go to High Desert Relief, as the meeting location has changed. As mentioned in the newsletter sent out earlier this month, our March meeting was changed to this Sunday, that's the 24th, 2013. The time still remains at 3:30 p.m. However, the location is at the Lovelace Main Hospital downtown. That's 601 Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Avenue in Albuquerque. Lovelace Hospital is off of Highway 25, north of Dr. Martin Luther King Drive. If you have trouble finding a location, Lovelace Hospital's number is 505-727-8000. And the meeting will be on the second floor in the Blandina room, just inside the cafeteria, at 3:30 p.m. The meeting will begin promptly at 3:30. So please drive and be prepared to be on time. Free parking is available east of the emergency room entrance, and that's the Patients Alliance meeting tomorrow. Now, we have a little news for you. Okay, this first story here is from Reason.com. It's called Hit and Run Blog, and the title is Treating PTSD with Medical Marijuana Could Curb Veteran Suicides. This is written by John J. Walters and was published yesterday, the 22nd of March. When T.J. Thompson returned home from serving in Iraq, the Veterans Administration put him on lorazepam, a high-potency, short-acting drug used to fight anxiety, insomnia, seizures, and aggression. It didn't work. Thompson's anxiety worsened until it almost killed him. In Thompson's own words, "I took 28 pills and blacked out one night. I also drank an 18-pack of beer in that same night. I declared that I would never take nor have the medication in my house again." His brush with death is tragically more common than you might think. U.S. military veterans are committing suicide at an increasing rate, averaging 22 per day. That's 20% higher than in 2007. Prescribing powerful psychotropic mood-altering drugs like lorazepam for most traumatic stress disorder, PTSD and anxiety, is common practice among military doctors. But thankfully, that's starting to change in response to the many negative side effects and almost total lack of observable positive effects from those drugs. According to Dr. Grace Jackson, a Navy psychiatrist who resigned in 2002 in protest of the pill pushing, clinical studies have shown these drugs to be no better than placebos, but far more dangerous in the treatment of PTSD. Part of the problem with treating PTSD with high intensity and generally high addictive pills is the tendency for veterans to self-medicate, according to Alec Dixon, a U.S. Navy veteran and the director of client relations for SC Laboratories. Veterans, whether Iraq, Afghanistan, Gulf, Korean, or Vietnam War vets, have largely self-medicated as a form of personal coping and treatment with PTSD. Often it is excessive binge consumption of alcohol alone or combined with a cocktail of other prescribed medications. Most vets and active duty military turn to alcohol from an inebriate standpoint due to the zero tolerance policy of cannabis within the UCMJ and historically with the Veterans Administration. But to say that the Veterans Administration is turning a blind eye to appalling number of military suicides, however, would be unfair. To their credit, they are open to alternative ways of solving the problem. Michael Krawitz, who we've had on our show before, by the way, Executive Director of Veterans for Medical Cannabis Access, that's the VMCA, and a plaintiff in the Americans for Safe Access versus the Drug Enforcement Agency, admits that the VA is trying to make progress. The Army and Veterans Administration are trying their best to deal with these issues and have gotten pretty creative, employing meditation, yoga, and even service dogs to assist vets dealing with PTSD. But they haven't yet discovered cannabis. Should they? The VMCA has collected an impressive amount of studies that suggest that medical marijuana is safer and a more effective way to treat PTSD and anxiety. They submitted it to the State of Michigan Department of Licensing and Regulatory Affairs in an attempt to convince the Michigan Medical Marijuana Review Panel that PTSD should be a qualifying condition for patients to be prescribed medical marijuana. They have also sent in similar packets to the New Mexico and Oregon. Now, of course, here, in New Mexico, we do have PTSD as one of the qualifications to get in the program. You can download the studies in the same format as they were submitted to the MDLRA here, and I'll put these up somewhere for you guys. If you want to email me, I can send it to you. Thompson has already turned from lorazepam to marijuana after his frightening experience. He says, I can use marijuana to help with the same anxiety symptoms and not worry about overdosing. Other vets are learning the same thing, but are forced to live in constant fear of arrest because marijuana is still illegal at the federal level. Even in cannabis-friendly states like Colorado, former U.S. Navy Corpsman Jeremy Usher is one such example. He had to obtain an expensive prescription for Marinol, a synthetic version of marijuana, the active ingredient THC, to manage his PTSD symptoms while on probation for three DUIs, all of which he accrued after returning from Iraq and Afghanistan in 2003. He is a poster boy for the self-medication that is all too common among the shell-shocked veterans who don't receive effective treatment. Admittedly, asking the DOD to turn a blind eye to recreational use of marijuana in states where it has been legalized seems to be a bit much. It is understandable for them to assert that soldiers and defense contractors must meet certain standards of readiness. But this outrageously outdated stance on marijuana that the military takes, which ignores the rapidly growing amount of scientific research, which shows the medical marijuana is cheaper, safer, and more effective means to treating PTSD, hurts our veterans and kills them. How many could we save by switching our treatment strategy away from psychotropic drugs and towards medical marijuana? It's worth finding out. And again, this is written by John J. Walters, who is a proud member of the U.S. Army Reserve.
And the gun against their shoulder, well, it gets a little older. And just like that older shoulder, it just gets put away. Oh, I'm an old forgotten soldier. Since they put an end to war, and I'd like to tell my story, but you don't wanna hear about the war. I'm an old forgotten campaign hero. Thank you.
Okay, we're back, and we're going to have Derek call in. Derek, you can call in anytime right now. We finished up the news, so call on in. And meanwhile, Derek will be talking about hemp, and I have a lot to learn about hemp. He's going to tell us a lot about hemp, and he's got cookbooks available on using it for nutrition. And I found a little thing on Facebook someone posted called Hemp Water, hempwater.org. And it says consuming hemp water can provide the following benefits: lower blood LDL cholesterol levels, lower blood pressure, improve cardiovascular circulation function, improve organ function, improve immunity levels, increase energy and levels and metabolic rate, reduce symptoms of PMS and menstrual cramps, reduced inflammation and symptoms of arthritis, improve recovery of muscles after exercise, reduce and treat dry skin and hair conditions, and reductions of many degenerative diseases through preventative measures. Hi, you're on Medical Marijuana Radio. Derek, welcome.
Yeah, yes, it is me. Thank
Fantastic.
You. Welcome.
Welcome, welcome. Listen, you know, I've been
Thank
wanting...
Thank you for having me.
My pleasure, my friend. We're going to touch... you know, obviously, we want to talk about your book and everything. But let's just give a little background first on the difference between, you know, the hemp plant and the cannabis sativa plant that we use with THC in it. Give us a little... A lot of us don't know about this.
Sure, and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to come on the show, is try to help others in your audience go ahead and know that there's it's a cousin. So I apologize, I'm hearing a little feedback. So what I have to tell your audience is hemp is the same family, but the industrial hemp, you have the ability to do so much more with it than you have with the medicinal plants. And
so
I found out by,
go ahead. Continue, please, Derek.
Yeah, no, I just found out that hemp has the healing potential on the industrial side versus the medicinal side. And that's how I like to separate it, the industrial nutritional versus the medicinal. So we separate it and try to clarify the difference between the two strains or varieties of cannabis.
Right. Genetically, they're the same family, but the hemp plant that that we used during the war, the war in the 40s, you know, World War II, that helped, you know, the government obviously was growing hemp, and they asked people to grow hemp so that they could make twine and all kinds of things for the war effort back in the 40s. And then, of course, they made it illegal after the war, and then we're sitting here now. There's so much that can be done with the regular hemp. Now, the hemp that you're talking about, the variety for nutrition and so forth, has virtually zero to just minuscule amounts of THC. So that's...
Yes, that's correct.
What else can you tell me besides CBD, which we're finding out now? What state are you in, Derek?
Currently, I live in Texas, and
okay, all right. Well, we won't talk about that. Texas is a tough state to be living in, you know.
Well, it is a tough state, but you know what? I belong to DFW Normal, and we're making some progress here. I mean,
I'm hearing
it's getting brought up in before legislation, so we're doing our share as far as the medicinal end. Overall, I'd like to see the nation go ahead and make it. I saw a fella, Jason, is it Jason Louie Love? I don't want to butcher his last name, out of Colorado. He had the first hemp plant in this capital. And he has the company called Hemp Cleanse.
Okay.
And so he's making progress as industrial hemp. And I know Kentucky Commissioner, Agricultural Commissioner, is making progress. Our politician in the Republican Party, Rand Paul, is all for industrial hemp. And more states are going to industrial hemp. They're putting it on their books. It's coming up for votes, and we're seeing numbers that are coming in pretty high.
I'm very enthused about that. I just want to say I'm very enthused about that. And I know if you're familiar with a company called Dixie X, Dixie Elixirs, Dixie Botanicals out of Colorado, they have Trip. You know, do you know Trip?
Yeah. Well, I've met him through LinkedIn, and I just talked to him via email, and he's one of the pioneers in the process.
I mean, he's got product out. He's got product out right now. I was trying to tell people.
And I love that process. Just the same. I haven't sampled it, but I could just say that America's going in the right direction.
Absolutely. It's slow, but it's accelerating. You know, I mean, I've been waiting 45 years for marijuana to be legalized. And, you don't know this, but my listeners probably do, that I worked for a dispensary for 2 years here in Santa Fe. And for the last 6 months or so, we were selling the Dixie X products. I think they changed it to Dixie Botanicals now. And I've seen with my own four eyes that the CBD that's contained in those capsules, his tincture, the capsules, tincture, and what's the other one he's got? Anyway, there's three products.
The botanicals.
They're working. Yeah. I mean, the salve. Okay. You know, I've had people, you know, have a sore shoulders. They put some of this Dixie X salve on there. No THC, purely CBD.
The topical. Yeah.
And the topical is working. You know, they're getting great results. And I've heard people, you know, just saying how it's really working for them. And of course, I hear that if you use a 1-to-1 ratio of CBD to THC, it's even more effective. So tell us about what else the industrial plant is good for health-wise.
Well, for health-wise, I stumbled across it for two reasons. One.
Thank you, Seinfeld.
I have eczema. I'm an eczema sufferer. And so I was trying to find a non-pharmaceutical something that I could put on my skin topically and take away the eczema. And the other one, part two, is as I had a hernia surgery and I have permanent nerve damage. So I was looking for something that could give me relief. And when I went to the doctors, I was prescribed pharmaceuticals that I would have to do long term and that had some serious side effects. And as a consumer of all products, as I'm now in my 40s, I'm learning, hey, let's read what's really on the back of the bottle and learn what we're consuming. Because we went through a generation there where we just trusted everybody. Oh, this is good to put on us. This is great to put on our skin. Oh, you'd put this on. Well, then the numbers of cancer just keep going up, 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 and up. Mm-hmm. And so here I am in my 40s, and I'm looking at now what am I putting in my body? And that's the importance I have to get out to your audience. You have to put organic naturals into your body, because with the hemp oil, what you put onto your skin is going in you, because we're porous. Mm-hmm. So I like explaining that industrial hemp oil, you can consume it right out of the refrigerator, right out of the bottle, drink it straight up, or put it on your skin, and then you never have to worry about toxicities of any chemicals. So unless you pour it into your eye, you don't have anything to really worry about. I drink at least 2 tablespoons a day, And I eat the hemp seeds, and I also incorporate it in our family's diets. And that's why I came up with the cookbooks. And all my friends were asking me, what do you do with the hemp seed? What do you do with the hemp oil? And on the industrial end, people are, my friends basically are saying, what are you doing, making pop brownies? And I try to, I try to break the stigma and say, no, I'm not making pop brownies. I am making healthy, nutritional meals for my family, and then I put it out there for everybody else too.
Now let me interrupt.
Whether you're going to have a smoothie.
Let me interrupt and ask you a question. You mentioned hemp oil. Now, are we talking about hemp seed oil that you go down to Whole Foods and buy in bottles, or are you talking about some other kind of hemp oil? So it is the stuff that hemp seed oil. Uh-huh. All right. So go ahead. Tell me about how you started.
There's two different types of hemp seed oil.
Go ahead.
Yeah, well, the hemp seed oil is different. I think your audience is more familiar with the Rick Simpson's oil, which is the high CBD, high THC concentrate oil.
Right.
I am talking about the industrial imported oil from Canada that we do not put in our farm fields here in America, which I'm ashamed that we don't. And that's my whole purpose of this video, actually. I love to cook with it, and I love to share. And I think America is so confused, and the stigma has to be broken.
Right.
So I use the industrial nutritional hemp oil that, yes, you can find at Whole Foods. I have a good friend at hippiebutter.com that sells hemp oil. And then there's other brands. Manitoba Harvest sells some, Nativa. And there's a lot of different hemp oil that you can, our customers can purchase over the counter. That's legal and healthy here in America.
And also, if they don't have a Whole Foods, there's other health food stores, obviously, other than them. And it's prominently on the shelves, in usually in the vitamin and nutrition department. So you decided that you wanted to incorporate this into your family's dinners and food and so forth. So tell us about your cookbook and what you started doing and how that's enhanced the diet of your family.
Well, I found out that hemp is high in omegas, 3s, 6s, and 9s. It's a completely digestible, high in protein. It's a vegan's and vegetarian's primary source of protein, other than like soy, because I'm a meat eater, but I know the vegans and vegetarian world are looking for something else to incorporate in their diet. There's also a couple other cookbook authors out there that have put out cookbooks. And I think they put them out about 10, 15, maybe even 20 years ago. And hemp is now making a stronger movement than it was then. And hats off to the hemp chefs that put those cookbooks out there. But when you're looking at something that is high in essential fatty acids, and you're getting the good fats into your diet, and the good fats are taking over the bad fats. So it's not really a weight loss, but it actually does take weight off. I was up to about 182 pounds, and then I got down to about 170. All I did was incorporate hemp into my diet, portion control, and then a lot of water, because water is also another important factor in our health.
So are you actually ingesting the hemp seed oil from the bottle, like with spoonfuls, or can you cook with that oil as if you were cooking with coconut oil or safflower oil or vegetable oil? Can you actually fry things in hemp oil, or is it go ahead.
No, sir. Yeah, it contains too much vegetation, so you can't fry with it, but you cook it at temperatures 150 degrees or less.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you have or obtain your hemp seed or hemp oil or hemp flour, you want to put it into the refrigerator because it's high in vegetation material. So you want to make sure it's either frozen, like I put my hemp seeds in the freezer and my hemp oil in the refrigerator. And hemp oil is really good for putting into like vinaigrettes or another salad type of dressing or oils, or I'll put it into anything that I need to add a little liquidity into and mm-hmm. substitute with olive oil, but I just won't, I won't cook at high temperatures because it'll burn.
So you're just like adding a little bit of hemp oil, hemp seed oil. I want to call it hemp seed oil because people are confused about, you know, hemp yes. oil. They're thinking about Rick Simpson and all that stuff. So so are you using like a 1-to-1 ratio, or are you just adding it just lightly to get some in there? Or is there a certain amount that you feel like X amount of tablespoons or whatever that needs to go into, let's say, on top of your salad or something that you're making?
Well, it does take a certain amount. You have to try to get the balance because hemp oil is a rich, nutty flavor, and it's kind of like a combination between sunflower seeds and pine nuts. Mm-hmm. So you want to get that consistency throughout. But like if you're going to make a hemp oil vinaigrette with lemon and garlic, you'll put approximately like 5 tablespoons of hemp oil. And then you put in some lemon, fresh garlic, and mustard or sugar or balsamic vinegar and sea salt. So that's where the cookbooks come in handy because it kind of lays it out there for you. And that's what our job as cooks is to try to get that happy neutral so mm-hmm. the flavors balance out.
So can you give us an example of a very simple recipe, you know, maybe 3 or 4 ingredients that to show us what is in your cookbook and what people can actually do with hemp seed oil in their nutrition?
Sure. Well, real quick, just what I touched base on was a hemp oil vinaigrette with lemon. And it's 5 tablespoons of hemp oil, 1.5 tablespoons of lemon, freshly squeezed, 1 to 2 cloves of fresh squeezed garlic. You could substitute a half a teaspoon of mustard or 1/2 teaspoon of sugar and put that in there. 1 tablespoon of balsamic vinegar, 1 dash of sea salt and black pepper to taste. And then I also throw an extra little couple tablespoons of hemp seed to blend right into my salad mm-hmm. and throw it on there. And that is
so
refreshing is all I have to say.
So the hemp seed that they sell at health food stores and online and so forth, they've been treated so that you can't grow the hemp plant from that, right? They've done something to it. What is it that they do? Do you know?
Well, the exact process I'm not 100% on, but I can tell you when you have purchased the hemp seed, it's already split, so there's no way that you can go ahead and plant it in the ground. So they do all that in Canada before you get it. Or if you want to get roasted hemp or roasted toasted hemp seeds with the shells on it, that's already done before you get it. So that process is already done in Canada.
So it's neutralized so that you can actually grow.
You could take, yes.
Yeah. Now in Canada, right. You know, in Canada, they do sell cannabis seeds, you know, that you know, for the THC, you know, for the medicinal side. Do they also sell hemp seeds, for the industrial hemp seeds? Do they sell that there?
I haven't. No, I don't believe they can, because it's illegal to grow here in America, and until it's legal to grow here in America, they won't provide that seed.
Even for Canadians, can Canadians buy hemp seeds, industrial hemp, and grow a hemp plant?
Oh yeah,
they can. Well,
I believe their process. They have to be registered farmers, mm-hmm. registered hemp farmers, to obtain the seed. And they do things a little different in Canada, but they're doing it. And it's a process that can be done. It was done here in America back in the 1800s. Or even earlier than that. I believe Christopher Columbus brought it back with him. And I think he was the first one to sow seed here in America. I may be wrong on that, mm-hmm. but I heard he had to bring hemp seed with him on his voyage because if they ever had to replace their sails that were made of hemp fabric, cannabis, they had enough hemp seed to regrow their crop to get home.
Right. Yes, I read that recently. That was very fascinating to me that they thought ahead of time to bring that with them. Of course, it would take
Right.
them, a half a year or who knows how a year to grow enough hemp to make a sale. But, if they were stuck on some
But
island,
back then, time didn't matter.
yeah, no, they had all the time in the world back then. So, did you hear
That's
me
right.
read this this thing about? Do you know anything about this hempwater.org? Have you heard of them?
I just heard of it from a girlfriend of mine who produced the Hempsters movie.
I don't know about that. What is the Hempsters
And
movie?
she was the first one to tell me about the Hempsters movie with Woody Harrelson. And you need to go check up on her movie. It's called The Hempsters, Planting the Seed, I believe it is.
Wow, okay. I don't know anything about it, but that's I'll look for them on Facebook. They probably have a Facebook page. So, again, I just wanted to go over a couple of the things that this hemp water says on their thing. It says consuming. First of all, I don't know. Is hemp soluble in water? I know that it's not. The cannabis sativa plant that we have THC in, the good stuff is not soluble in water. So, what do you think these guys are doing? Any ideas?
I believe that they're soaking it and then filtering it out, but I haven't tried it yet. I know I've seen their website and I'm waiting for more information. I think we all are.
Yeah.
But I believe that their product is going to contain the nutrients and all the biomaterials that give you the omegas and all the vitamins A, B, D, and E that can be found in hemp seed. So
Well, I know that for years they've been touting it, the omega-3s, that's a good thing to have. And I also know that people use the Rick Simpson type hemp oil medicinally, and they mix in some hemp seed oil into that in order to help it go through your digestive system a little easier than just using the hash oil that people are using for medicine. Give me some more
that's
good
correct.
stuff on hemp, because people just really don't know about it. There's a lot of myths, and then now we're finding out there's so much truth. So what else interesting can you tell us about that?
Well, there's something interesting when you talk about hemp as as the plant. From what I gather from like the Department of Agriculture, hemp can be grown in rows very close together, like corn would grow. And also, hemp puts nitrogen back into the soil. It's one of many plants that do, but it puts nitrogen back in. It does not need to be, excuse me, it doesn't have to use a lot of pesticides. It doesn't need a lot of amounts of water to grow. And after about, I think it's about 12 weeks, maybe 13 weeks. It's grown so high that weeds won't grow. So farmers used to use it as a rotation crop because they didn't have to do so much work in their farm fields when they were plowing with horses that they could go ahead and plant something different in there and not have to turn their fields over so often. But my understanding is hemp can grow in the same field forever.
Just keep
Also, hemp.
regenerating itself.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'll keep regenerating itself. But as far as America's concern is, the difference between hemp and marijuana is that when hemp grows, like I've heard this reference before, that if you had 100 acres and you were a licensed hemp farmer, that hemp is cut down at a certain time. It harvests at a certain time than you would a medicinal marijuana. Medicinal marijuana, it has a longer harvest time is what I gather. And so if you're a hemp farmer and your neighbor is a marijuana farmer, you may have problems because hemp will actually reduce the numbers of THC. It's a more dominant plant and it reduces the THC in its cousin. So medicinally, you would want to make sure that in America, if you were to legalize both across the board, you would have to have a happy medium somewhere.
I did hear some people talking about this the other day, and they said that the industrial hemp plant, the pollen, the male pollen, can travel up to 9 miles, which is really, really crazy.
It could, well, depending on winds, it could probably, yeah, it could probably grow a lot further, but you have to look at a whole total, yeah, I mean, you're looking at agricultural effects. I mean, you would have to get the Department of Agriculture to actually figure it out, but I'm sure pollen can probably grow or blow a lot further than that. But hemp is a plant that contains 0.03 or less of THC in it, and it actually reduces the THC in its cousin. I find that truly amazing.
Well, right, and it would water it down.
In the 1930s.
I'm just going to say that it would dilute the gene pool, obviously, if you crossed the industrial hemp plant to the medicinal cannabis plant. Do you know if, like, when a female industrial hemp plant is budding and flowering and maturing and growing, does it have the same looking flowers as the cannabis medicinal plant with THC?
Well, as far as my research shows, and I just heard from Andrea Herman that she stated that the flowering of industrial hemp is about the same as medicinal marijuana. So that's where America says they can't decipher the two, but it grows differently because if America were to grow hemp grows close together in rows like corn. Medicinal marijuana grows feet apart. So in Canada, they're able to decipher in the fields who has what permits to grow what.
Very, very, very.
So I think America can figure that out.
Well, if I'm not mistaken,
and I know they have a lot of aerial shots.
Oh, I've seen those. Even the industrial hemp plant is just so beautiful, and they grow very, very tall. I've seen 20-foot plants in pictures and so forth. Now, in Colorado, with their Amendment 64 to legalize, they've also legalized industrial hemp. Isn't that correct?
Well, it's on the books. I believe it passed, so I think what they're going to do, what I read last, is they're going to do like 10-acre test plots so they can get it down pat. So it'll be a couple of years. Even if America were to go ahead and pass it tomorrow, all 50 statewide, to grow industrial hemp, I think it will have to go through a process. So,
well, you know, we're all pioneers.
That's all I have.
Yeah, we're all pioneers in this. Okay, in the industrial hemp business, in the medicinal marijuana business, now the recreational marijuana business. This is all happening right now as we're speaking. There's people all over Washington State and Colorado in little rooms trying to figure things out. It's the beginning of what many of us have been waiting for so many years. And there's so much to learn about industrial hemp and cannabis, and what Tripp is doing with Dixie is just amazing to me, and he's so far ahead of the curve. Okay, he's figured out how to extract that CBD that is so important for cancer and for so many other kinds of diseases. Do you know anything about what his process? I mean, I'm sure it's a private process that he's got, but do you have any ideas about whether the CBD can be extracted from the plant, like we extract the CBD and the THC from the THC plant? It seems to me like the process would probably be the same. We're sucking out those good cannabinoids.
Well, I think you hit something there right on the head, but my gathering is, with all the studies going, I think Canada right now only tests for THC because they're in the import. I don't know all the regulations, and you drive a right point right to home, because they don't test for CBDs as far as I know in industrial hemp. Now, to my knowledge, I have no idea what the CBD content is in industrial hemp.
Well, obviously, it's enough
so
that...
So I think America needs to find out. It's probably there.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, it's there, because that's how Dixie is getting the CBD that they're selling with zero THC in it, and they're allowed to mail it across state lines. They're allowed to sell it. So obviously, there's no THC in it, and they figured out how to extract that CBD. I mean, I've seen the capsules. People have taken them that I know. And, you know, there's 25 milligrams of CBD in each one of their little caps. And if I had, you know, if I knew someone with cancer, if I had cancer, boy, I'd be popping these things along with the Rick Simpson oil and so forth. So I'm guessing that the process...
Well, I agree on that, but I don't know. You'd have to check on the Dixie Elixirs website. I don't think they mail across state lines. I don't want to.
They do.
Make a
no, no. Here. I can tell you they do because, you know, being here in New Mexico, and they're in Colorado. Uh-huh. Dixie X is being sold in many medical marijuana states, but it can also be sold to anyone. I think Dixie X has their own website. You can order from them, and it can be shipped across state lines. Yeah, it's amazing. If you needed it there in Texas, you can go right online and order it and get the salve, the tincture, and the pills. It's an amazing thing, and when I worked for the dispensary, I placed a big order and we had it and we were selling it and I'm not with the dispensary anymore, but I know that it's still an ongoing thing. So this is something that people from all over the world now can order, this pure CBD. Now, if you're in a medical state and you want to treat yourself with this CBD, and you can also get THC cannabis. Again, the two of them together, I hear a 1-to-1 ratio is very, very effective. But on the other hand, there are people who are sick with certain diseases but don't want to feel the high from the medicinal marijuana plant. This way, you know, they can use the Dixie CBD. And they won't get high. It's impossible for them to get high, but they're going to get the benefit from the CBD. So it's all very, very exciting what's happening now with the discovery that the CBD is so important. But we can't forget that along with that, THC is what I think Rick Simpson feels is really what's killing cancer cells in a lot of people. So what else would you like to touch on that you want to get out to the public? Because, again, we don't know a lot about the industrial hemp plant.
Well, I would like to just stress upon the industrial hemp that it's high in omegas, 3s, 6s, and 9s. And I know that, like a female that is pregnant, it is an excellent source of omegas, 3s, 6s, and 9s, where... if they're trying to look for a fish oil that has the high in omegas, I know omegas, when my wife was pregnant, our OB let her know that it could have toxicity in it, and industrial hemp doesn't have the mercury levels that you would find from fish oil.
Right. So
that's a bonus.
Sure. Be a pure way of getting omega-3s. Because obviously our oceans
also that hemp seed is not a nut, so it doesn't contain the hypoallergenics. So like kids, when you're making cookies, like I'll make a hemp seed oatmeal cookie, and you don't have to worry about kids having a allergy effect to it because it's a seed versus a nut.
The whole thing about children being allergic to nuts and peanuts, it seems to have happened over the last 15 or 20 years. I don't remember ever hearing about it when I was younger, and it's got to be...
I never remember it.
I don't know what it's a very strange thing.
It's all the crap that we eat. It's all the crap that we eat. Yeah. That's all I have to say. Well, you're full of nutrients with hemp. You have zinc, calcium, you have vitamins A, B, D, and E. Hemp will actually lower your cholesterol. And it's in China remedies, they used to eat hemp seed to make your stool soft, so you would have better bowel movements, which is so you don't have to worry about colon cancers. I mean, it sounds a little grotesque to say that, but hemp is that positive for people to incorporate into their diets. I can't stress it enough.
You know, I've said this before on the show and in private that one of the problems with convincing non-believers about hemp and cannabis sativa with THC in it is that it works for such a diverse amount of diseases and conditions that people go, now, you know, this is BS. I mean, how can this work for everything, you know? So but we're going to find out in the next couple of years that people like you and other people that have been pushing hemp and Rick Simpson and all that, that there really is miracle benefits. I mean, we're seeing it now. People are getting cured from cancers, okay? It's all anecdotal. It's not under, you know, studies or anything. But now that Colorado and Washington are legal, they're going to be able to do their own studies in those states. So this is the beginning of hopefully curing cancer. I don't know that it's going to work for everybody, but
it's not going to work for everybody, but it'll work for probably a 60 to 70% of America. And then when you incorporate the health and nutrition back into your diets, because that's what your doctor doesn't ask you. Mm-hmm. Hey, Larry, what are you eating? Why is your blood pressure so high? They don't get to the root. A good doctor will ask you, hey, what are you eating? Oh, well, I eat this and that. A good doctor just gets into your whole spectrum of health. Are you getting enough water? Are you getting enough nutrients? Our body is craving all this nutrients. And that's why I love hemp so much, is because it heals both on the inside and on the out. So you're able to put it on your skin. You don't have to worry about rushing off to the hospital in case you ingest it. And it has vitamin D, so it's an actual skin block. Mm-hmm. So I love it. I tell everybody I'm a hempaholic.
Well, there's not much of a downside.
I eat it, I drink it, and you know.
There's not much of a downside.
We used to pay our taxes with hemp.
Yeah. You know, we just...
And,
what I've seen is that what my feeling is that we've wasted 100 years by putting the prohibition...
75 years.
Well, to me, it seems like 100. You know what I mean? I mean, the people were using it in the 1800s. And
how old are you, Larry?
I'm 63 in a couple of months. And so, you know,
okay,
I've been...
Well, happy birthday.
I want you to give out...
I'm just...
Go ahead, Derek.
I'm just saying, for the past 63 years now, you have to look back. Yeah, you want to say almost 100 years, hemp has been out of our... out of our life, which is a terrible mess, because in the 1930s, you're looking at William Randolph Hearst, the paper industry.
Right.
That's where hemp went out. DuPont. You can thank William Randolph Hearst, the DuPont family, because they came out with the synthetic nylon. And as we know, hemp is the strongest fiber known to man from a plant kingdom. And then that was competition in the industry. So that's where the lines cross between the marijuana and the hemp. And hemp has actually been crucified. I'm not saying marijuana hasn't, but they both have. And it was due to the almighty dollar.
Right. We look at all the
1938,
trees.
1938, I think it was. Popular mechanics.
I was going to say, look at all the trees we could have saved.
One,
you
know? One ratio. Absolutely. Yeah. Hemp will produce... 1 acre of hemp will produce 4.1 acres of tree paper pulp.
Yeah.
So if you do that, you can actually have two crops a year here in America in certain regions. Like here in Texas, we could have almost two crops a year because hemp grows within a 120-day cycle. So that's where my drive is. Mm-hmm. Is we need to get hemp back into our fields. We need to provide jobs. We need to provide food. We need to provide fuel and fiber for America. And that's where my little cookbook comes into play. It's not a lot, but it puts nutrition back into people's diet. People are going to get healthier. You're going to get the full effect of the EFAs, the essential fatty acids, and that actually burns the fat. So the good fat will take away the bad fat. And I love hemp. I'm a hempaholic. I put it in my smoothies. I put it in my salads. I put it in our meals. I'll eat it right off the spoon. And back in the day of George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Ben Franklin, they all grew hemp. Abraham Lincoln, they knew the value of hemp.
Right.
Hemp was going to be the next billion-dollar crop in 1938.
You know, I'm very excited about all the changes that are coming right now. And how can people get your cookbook and read your blogs and so forth? Can you give out your contact information, please?
Sure, I'd love to. My blog is hemphealthytoday.blogspot.com, and I can be found at Facebook at Hemp Healthy Today, and my cookbooks are at bakespace.com, and then you just look for Hemp Healthy Today or Hemp or Google me at Derek Cross and bakespace.com, or you can also find me at Twitter at Hemp Healthy the number 2 day. And you'll find me, and you'll find my recipes. And I'm actually one of the first in America to have a small e-cookbook out there. And I'm working on the dinner menu, and I'm looking to put out many, many more. So,
well, Derek Cross, thank you very much for being. Thank you very much, Derek, for being on our show today and enlightening the people around the country and around the internet on industrial hemp and its nutritional value and its healthy value. And I thank you for your hard work and fight the good fight there in Texas, because we need to turn that around there. You know, if Texas becomes a legal medical marijuana state, or if they legalize hemp, I think, you know, we got the biggest state in the country involved. So thank you, Derek, and feel free if you have anything to call in about in the future to call in the show. So you have a wonderful evening, and thanks for being a guest on Medical Marijuana Radio.
Thank you very much, sir.
Have a good evening. So that's Derek Cross from Texas, but fighting the good fight about hemp. And we'll be right back.
The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana Radio, Radio Show.
The Medical Marijuana for you and me.
Well, I want to thank Derek Cross, and you can get him on HempHealthyToday.blogspot.com. Facebook is Hemp Healthy Today, and Twitter is at Hemp Healthy the number 2 day. And that was very interesting. I did learn a lot. I didn't have a lot of knowledge about the industrial hemp, but I'm looking forward to it becoming legal. I want to thank my two radio mentors, both with the initials HS, for their inspiration. And don't forget to F. Bishop's Lodge, Wells Fargo, Cannabis.com for not being very friendly to medical marijuana patients. And one more F is maybe next week I'll think of it. Anyway, good luck, everybody. Feel well. We'll catch you next week.
Yes, the medical, medical, the medical, the marijuana for you and me. The medical, the medical, 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 medical marijuana.
Shabbat. Shalom.
Feel well, everybody. Good night.